Okay. Evolution inside the concrete jungle. Hello, everyone. Welcome to tonight's episode. Hopefully, my voice is loud and clear. I wanted to speak about an interesting thought, an interesting ideology. That we human beings at some point, we stepped out of the natural food chain. And what that means is that we stepped outside a sort of turbulent dynamic that was imposed upon us by nature and by the nature of our design. So as human beings stepped out of the food chain, they were no longer being chased by the wilderness of a savage world. They eventually built, intelligent dimensions, more civilized dimensions in a savage world. The ancient Greeks had a saying to tame the savageness of man and make gentler the life of this world, make gentle the life of this world. And what that means is this effort towards gentleness as a civilization has led us to our current modernity. Now, survival is very crucial because an act of entering civilization, kind of our modernity, came about as a result of the ancients kind of deciding this was the path to go. So the path ahead is to some degree paved before we were born. However, this evolution in the concrete jungle has a different set. It's kind of like you're still in a jungle, yet there are different things to be alert of. When you are in the jungle, imagine we were back in the food chain. Right now, we are superior in the food chain. That means factories like meat factories and these slaughter places, like that's a sign that we're on the top of the food chain. And it's our intelligence. Therefore, it was an advancement of our intelligence. But the reason is, the point I'm trying to make is that we have animalistic instincts. Because we started from a savage mindset and then became civilized, that civility is under thin ice. And when cruelty leads to a certain level, those animalistic instincts come back. You know, it's like when a person gets angry, there's something liberating about that anger because it's an expression of a way where life is being seen. You see, we are self-expressive creatures. You have to express yourself or your sense of self fades. This is the kind of maturity that comes from mystical silence and in some sense, divine noise. Evolution inside the concrete jungle is a suggestion that it's not that we stepped out of the food chain, it's just that we transformed the food chain. And so the values that we try to protect, there is resistance against them. One can say there's two types of resistance in this life. Either you're internally resisting the external phenomena, or you are externally resisting the internal phenomena. Believe it or not, there needs to be a balance in both. You cannot go and kind of plant your flag on an extreme edge of a state of mind. What that means is I want you to think that every moment of your existence, it's as if various rooms you're in some sense entering and passing through and traveling through. It's a traveling through various states where being exists, appears to itself. You know, that is the human intelligence to some degree. But in the concrete jungle, this is where survival has become more multidimensional. You know, back in the day, the guy had to just be aware like an animal didn't attack him and had to find food and shelter and certain basic necessities. Now, those basic necessities don't occupy us as much. Rather, a new domain, as if like a sort of universe was found in the physical universe, where we call it the social universe, which has to do with the minds of people and a sort of subjective communication. So it's no longer enough that we just look like physically like creatures. Like we say, okay, that's a human being. That guy's a human being. That guy's. It's like it's not just enough identifying the human physicality. Now we have to, in some sense, find behind the eyes the nature of the human. Because I'm telling you, you can look like a human, but behind your eyes, you could not be human. You could not have human values. You can have programmed values. You can have mechanical values. It's as if sometimes when I see certain violence and cruelty occurring, it's as if I am seeing an uncontrollable machine, as if we are kind of lost to a cycle that our unconscious is moving rather than our conscious mind. You see, the permission of reality and existence as a conscious moment it's like an authorization for phenomena to occur in accordance to a certain input. Our free will can be said to be a sort of influence upon the world, as much as the world is an influence upon our free will. And we have to see what we have in our control. That is the most crucial thing. That is the most important thing to study, I find. People are losing sight of subjective value, and what's occurring is that people are evolving into an emotional intelligence, or they're relying on an emotional intelligence more than an intellectual intelligence. You see, the intellectual intelligence, I find, takes more energy. That means it's harder to think about it takes more energy, like literally more energy, to think about something rather than just to feel something. If you notice, emotions tend to be singular. That means if I told you, like, imagine there was a, when I say emotions are singular, what that means is, like, when you feel sad, you feel sad. It's as if the whole moment is found within that atmosphere. Okay, so what I'm saying is that an emotion is a singular interpretation of phenomena. The intellect and what we consider to be knowledge is a multidimensional kind of projection of phenomena. That means as I'm speaking to you right now, I have to have multidimensional considerations, or if I didn't, what would atoms have to say to other atoms? We would instantly see if we don't input the inner meaning into the outer meaning will have no meaning, you see? And so this takes us to, I believe it was the Stoics, let me double check this. Okay, there we go. The Stoics often refer to the four cardinal virtues of Greek philosophy: prudence, justice, fortitude, and temperance. Okay. So you see, what I'm trying to say is that the Stoic mindset, of course, I was kind of introduced to it through the meditations of Marcus Aurelius, which is a great book for listeners to look into. Because the thing was, Marcus Aurelius was an emperor, and when we look at back in the day, our ancestors had to pay more attention to the advancement of behavioral phenomena than, in some sense, true measurement. It's as if science wasn't born yet before there was many other sorts of ideologies floating around. Okay, when science was born, science was that kid in the family who decided to not join the family business. And what that means is pretty much the ancient world had this notion that what we see is not just what we see, there is things in behind the scenes. So we can see that the ancients appreciated the behind the scenes because their attention was not just limited to a materialistic conclusion. When we became social creatures, when we became tribal creatures, that's when materiality and the material universe totally got a new refined value. So what I'm trying to say is that when you really look at what a person is, imagine right now, I ask you, Mr. Within, I ask you, like, you were right here, and I ask you, okay, who are you, man? And you said, like, a sentence. You said, like, a paragraph. You gave me some speech, okay? I would say, I would then realize that speech, if it can be written down, what you've told me, it can be scoped and zoomed in on such a point that I can see how your mind has authorized conception to sequentially arise. This is why many people don't understand listening, and I was kind of blessed. You know, I think I was blessed to realize this because I was, I had this friend, close friend of mine, and his older brother and him and me, I was the similar age as him. And what happens is, so me and this kid's older brother and him, we go to this camping trip and we're by the fire, and it's kind of that point where dialogue has begun and we're speaking and whatnot, you know. Sorry about that, guys. Had to answer a phone call there. Evolution is something very fascinating to study and to try to comprehend. For me, intelligence has nothing to do... how can I tell you? It's as if you're functioning in two worlds. One world is in accordance to what your experiences have activated for intellectual phenomena to occur, and the other is in some sense what is authorized. So what I'm saying right now is that the reason I'm saying these words instead of other words is because they have found an authorization with the images, with the landscape I see behind my eyes. Because you might think that you might close your eyes and it's just pitch black emptiness, but it is not. There is some sort of subtle movement going on. This subtle movement primarily arises as an observer of a phenomenon, but even that observer and that mentality that there is an observer and mindset that there is an observer will shift, because the unknown has a power that surpasses any knowledge. That is what I have realized. We have not come in this world to just paint our own pictures and stare at them till the end of time. We have in some sense come to find that next level brush that is it's going to paint the new story of the civilization. We have to in some sense apply. And what are we applying? The fascination of our interior realms to our exterior realms. So Mr. Within is saying that it's very easy to think that you're one person, right? And it's so easy to think that in some sense you're just one being. But when you pay attention to it, I don't even understand how we're defining our sense of sanity as a civilization. Let me tell you why. Because we say, like we have psychologists speak about, I've heard of course Jordan Peterson speak on this, but in some sense a fragmentation of the psyche. Okay, a fragmentation of the psyche means that the inner vision has divided or is held. So you see, you have two types of attention. Right now, as I'm giving this talk, for example, I have an externalized attention. I'm aware this laptop is here. I'm aware my phone's here. I'm aware, like, I have headphones on, you know, there's, like, you see? So there's an awareness to the location, to the physical appearance of the intelligence of the moment. But in some sense, I also care. It's something I didn't care when I was younger. When I was younger, when I heard ideas of the soul and whatnot, I was like, okay, man, I don't even know what this mind is. You want me to believe in a soul? Like, you know, give me a break. What I'm saying is different generations of people and the different sight through DNA has acknowledged the world. Like, what I'm trying to say is that attention has moved in different ways on this planet. In its attempt to move in different ways, it has lit up different parts of this world of ours. And so we are suddenly seeing the relationship of the past and the future has to do with the change of space in a certain time. You see, so it's as if you need time to be able to consider you live through different moments. If you don't have the concept of time, how can you have a personality? How can you even define the personality? Because we are a character in a story, we tend to be defined by where in the story we move through. So we are a creature defined by its setting, And it has been going on like this. You know, every ancestors of yours has opened his eyes and he's like, okay, I'm this, I'm this, I'm this. And we have all accepted very early on that objectivity is a majority of our experience of life. So Mr. Within is kind of saying, dear human being, let's think about this. When a creature comes into manifestation, how much of its experience of life throughout its whole lifetime? So imagine you lived a life and we were like a pigeon in the sky wondering about this fullness of life you lived. And what portion of it were you externally inspired, you actually cared for the external living reality, and how much of it was internally directed? You see, your attention can move in different ways. That's how words, in some sense, play around. For me, I realized something very profound. It's something that children kind of have, but they lose. And they have to lose. It's kind of like the death of the inner child, as the true levels of the experience of reality are kind of expressed. So it's like only those who have gone through hardship can conceptualize what it would be to, in some sense, experience an easier life, for example. And this is the next great question, guys. How does intelligence on this planet evolve beyond the story? And in some sense, we can't let go of our stories. And if there was a chance to get rid of the last ego on Earth, those hands would be denied. You cannot throw away your illusion. Because if you do, you will have no truth. This is why pure enlightenment is not for an individual. Did you know that? No person has ever gotten enlightened. Because it is not for a person. It is the transcendence of the personality into the presence of the universal sector, which Mr. Within is saying is attributeless. It has to be. That means you become the observer as if you were never this body, you were always this mind, and then you suddenly realize you were never this mind, you were the unknown. And that's where liberation aligns. And in some sense, your imagination opens up. Wow, this is something crucial. I mean, I've decided to constantly move the direction of these talks because I feel that there's going to be a renaissance in the future. I call it playfully the multidimensional renaissance. But in some sense, this renaissance is an inner renaissance. It's an internal transformation of the value of the self. Because if the value of yourself doesn't change, that means you haven't lived. You see, it's kind of funny. We go to bed and we sleep and we forget what happened. And we wake up to a new day. But when we are, for example, about to physically transition from this reality, we suddenly are like, oh no, what about all this life that I didn't live? And so you see, it's in some sense an acknowledgement of phenomena. That's intelligence. You see what's happening. What other intelligence can there be? And so it was this, let me see if I could find the perfect quote. Here, check this out. So Rumi, this poet from 700 years ago, this ancient Sufi mystic Persian poet, he says, this is a gathering of lovers. In this gathering, there is no high, no low, no smart, no ignorant, no special assembly, no grand discourse, no proper schooling required. There is no master, no disciple. This gathering is more like a drunken party full of tricksters, fools, and men and mad women. This is a gathering of lovers. What that means is there is the chaotic impulse. But that's not the exact quote I wanted to find. Jesus Christ, man. Is it even from this guy, the quote on that? Okay, I can't find it, but I'll share another Rumi quote. He says, your task is not to seek love, but to find all the barriers within yourself that you have built against it. So let's just replace, instead of love, true intelligence. Let's say your task, it's like you realize you're not meant to run after true intelligence, you know, like a curious cat, but you're meant to see the limits of your knowledge, which automatically, once confronted, experientially update you. The peak evolution of a thought is into a replication of reality. That means the greatest thought will be indistinguishable from reality. You know? It's like that's when the greatest emotion is generated. You know, when you are about to touch truth, yet there's that millimeters of space between your hand and the divine, your finger and the divine. The concrete jungle commands us to survive, as all jungles do. But they also command us to observe order, observe the chaos enough we find a new order. So imagine right now that what I'm going to say next, the reason I'm saying is because I think 700 years from now, something like this could potentially occur. So I'm saying, imagine if we were in there now. And what is the situation? This is a situation in humanity where natural life has been transformed into programmed intelligence. It is kind of the death of nature in its own creation, as if a part of nature created something that made itself disconnect from nature. The ability to give sight new meaning through the application of your free will as a free action. Pretty much the sages said all of life comes down to two things. You either trust it or you don't trust it. Any moment you don't trust, your intelligence locks down. Any moment you trust, your intelligence activates. And you see something very fascinating, that all these religions that are guiding people towards love, you know, why did they say you have to love God? What if God wanted to be hated, for example? Right? What if in the holy book it was written you must hate God to show your love of God? And so you'll see, for example, of course there's an ideological constitution there, but I'm saying the reason it was love was because in love there is more trust. Any moment there is trust in, your originality steps out. If you don't trust the moment, you hide behind the veils that the world appears in. To be honest, we are creatures that our greatest technology is not the phones in our hands. It's what we input into those phones. It is the ability to communicate. So Mr. Within finds that it's not random that we're just all creatures speaking to one another. You know, there's an intention of nature here that surpasses whatever kind of social ideology we place upon it. You know, because fundamentally, all branches of knowledge are connected to the same trunk. That means the social psychologist requires results from biologists, for evolutionary biologists to kind of comprehend the psychology of society now. So you see, in different phases of history, different people lived, and as they lived, they opened up various realities. Now, they also had a reality themselves, and they had to communicate it. So you see, the issue with history is that whoever wrote it was limited to their experiences and comprehension of what they wrote. So many scribes knew, this is why kind of scribes aren't mentioned in history, because on some level they are transforming the work to keep it going. You see? It's like, for example, a lot of Rumi's poems are from a different language being interpreted into a different language. And this creates a challenge of true translation. Is it ever possible to truly translate a cultural value into another cultural value? And I find there's an impossibility there. You know, there's a genetical impossibility there. The fact that we consume what we are fed early on, that means if you think of it this way, when you were a child, you did not just they didn't just spoon feed you baby food, they also spoon fed to you ideology, and these ideas have projected a world and a spectrum of a world where the free will chooses itself from. You are cherry picking yourself in the moment in accordance to your emotion and just simply the thought generation that occurs. So what that means is we have to be playful, because to be accurate in a world where chaos exists is a waste of time. You know, it's kind of like trying to measure the sky. Who can create such a big ruler? And whoever creates such a big ruler, they will realize the ruler was their own mind. That is the fascination of the world. We're not even acknowledging this world to be multidimensional simply because we don't know what to do with multidimensionality. And that's a very valid point. You know, the reason why people are not considering deeper dimensions to their intelligence is simply because they're still trying to figure out the current dimensions that are accessible to them. You see, it's like, what is the motivation of the person? Does it have to do with their inner vision, or does it have to do with their outer appearance? That is very crucial. There's a lot of girls nowadays who look at themselves in the mirror and they feel they're not valued properly. You know, and I will tell you, this is a kind of mask of society. The society is, we're all wearing masks in society. I don't know any human being who can enter a social system where there's more than two people around and that person doesn't have a mask. The person has multidimensional layering of masks, and these masks are limited to how far the other person can see them, right? So this is why when we have conversation between random people in the street or whatever, like two people at a coffee shop talking, what we find is that there isn't an activation of truth yet. People are still wearing their masks. It is only when they can acknowledge certain ways that things have been real to both of them, that eventually they can have a sort of common ground to build the empire of their relationship in, you know? Anyways, guys, I hope this talk has served you. The concrete jungle is still a jungle. What that means is there is what chaos and order about. So how you manage yourself is that any moment there is chaos, also gaze from the order. Any moment there is order, also gaze from the chaos. We have to keep both wings of this civilization working at the same time. That means Mr. Within is saying, all those people trying to be good, keep doing what you're doing. All those people who are trying to be bad, keep doing what you're doing until you run in the hamster wheel to such a point where you suddenly see beyond your own value. When you see beyond your own value, that always comes across as a divine experience. Kind of like how this kid who is like has a picture of a celebrity, poster of a celebrity on his wall, suddenly meets that celebrity and it's like euphoria. It's like the kid's wanted a certain experience, suddenly he gets it and oh my God, you know? And and of course those experiences are relatively artificial, but the kind of euphoric experience, like I've literally seen Will Ferrell in this YouTube video walk in the street and these mothers kind of like cry when they see Will Ferrell. Because of all the moments of joy this man's ridiculousness has brought people, you know? So it's so it's one of those things that you realize you cannot avoid what you naturally are. And this is why the intuition must be listened to. It is the call of nature in a mechanical world, in a world that is becoming more technological, in a world where freedom forgot where it's from. As Dylan Thomas brilliantly said to his father on his deathbed, on his father's deathbed, he said, rage. He said, do not go gentle into that good night. Rage. rage against the dying of the light. What that means is you have one lifetime, live your true expression. What else can you do? I hope this talk has served you guys. Much blessings and namaste.